Anyway, the Thaw, the famous Thaw. People usually mean by that, that wonderful time when one very dark and cold period of the Soviet history has ended and the new flourishing thing has begun. And then for whatever reason, it ended in about 10 years and things started to go back into the dark. Well, I, as you could probably guess by now, I don't really support that point of view. So it was as important and as controversial era in our history as any other, because, you know, history, especially recent history, is a very live thing. It's really hard to talk about it without passion, if you really care. And there are views, opposing views on the same periods. And, you know, there are just different opinions, and we'll see, the history will say it word, but it's word, but it's going to be much later. So yeah, there is a lot of truth to the opinion that I quoted earlier, but it's also, if you look at the more, if you look deeper, it's also the time when a lot of lies have been introduced into the society, and a lot of trends have been established that ultimately contributed a lot to the demise of the Soviet Union, which to me is a shame. Anyway, the promised boring stuff. I mentioned in the previous slide, there was a thing I put that for many people, it felt like they were reaping the fruits of the extraordinary effort that they have put in over the many, many past years. And just to illustrate what that was, ever from the start of this, of the new country, people have lived under a big stress, constant big stress, because they inherited, they took over a country that has been ravaged by the civil war. And the new war was coming and coming soon, and it was not a secret to anyone. The country had no chance to, they stood no chance in that coming war. So to have that chance, the people, the country, everybody, they had to put in significant effort to industrialize, to develop completely new industries that never existed before, to build plants on which you build tools with which you then build stuff that helps you win the war. And while doing that, you have to invent the new economy, the new political system, the whole big things that actually run the country. You have to invent it, you know, and you just do it on the fly. Plus, nobody, of course, nobody wanted to give the new country, the new system a break. So the imminent threat, the threat was very real. It was immediate, it was constant. So all that contributed to people living, the whole people, like the whole country, living in the very, I don't know, in the emergency mode. There were so many things to do and so little time to do this, but yeah, it had to be done. And of course, the war did come, and the results were just devastating. Yes, we won, and that was a huge validation of everything that was done before, but of course it came at a huge price as well. You could see some of the numbers that when I was putting it together, I was shocked with them. So I don't know, half the country, a third of the country was totally destroyed and had to be rebuilt. And of course it was the part of the country that was most developed industrially, economically. So the impact was just devastating. When you get that, you have to restore, to give people back life that would even resemble normal life. You have to put a lot of effort into restoration. And yes, that's what the country did. That's what they started to do. The first 5 years after the war, of course, the focus was again on the heavy industries, which then would result in other industries that would serve people's needs more directly, like the consumer needs. But first, the foundation had to be built and rebuilt before putting on, you know, the decorative stuff or some, you know, less foundational pieces. So there were problems. They were huge, huge achievements. They were also problems. Again, I don't want, I hate it when people just read from the slides. If you need me to slow down or just say some of the numbers I have here, some of the things, I would be glad to. But the point I'm trying to lead to is that by the beginning of 1950s, that huge, enormous, extraordinary effort started to pay off. The country was restored mostly restored. The new construction has begun on housing. The life started to feel like it was a life in peace, no longer a huge emergency. A new beautiful buildings were built everywhere. You could see some of the famous buildings in Moscow, in Kiev, in Minsk, all over the country. So the country was reborn pretty much. Well, in 1953, Stalin dies, and the following political games have led to very, very controversial results that did mark an end of a huge era. Before I move on, I would like to bore you just a little bit more. So I know the phrase originally says desperate times call for desperate measures, but I would like this. I would like to reuse the word extraordinary here. So when the country was first, again, I'm talking about the new Soviet country, it was first born, they were truly extraordinary times. So the system of government had to be truly extraordinary. And the party, the Communist Party, was the only tool that was able to tie together all the different regions to convey the management signals, to send the feedback back to the center, help in making decisions and enforcing the decisions. As the times went by, more and more focus was shifted to the actual government offices, different government institutions. The party started to play more of a controlling body rather than the actual executive branch. And you could really see, this is too deep. I don't want to go into deep, but you could see by the positions, the official positions, that the upper, in the inner circle of people around Stalin would have. When the war came, that all changed back. So there was one body of power. There was a law passed, there was a law that made the State Defense Council the ultimate power body of the country. It worked. It did get us through the war. But after that, when the times were still tough, it was hard to give back that efficiency that the single power body would provide. So the reforms were slow, but by the end of the Stalin era, the reforms were planned and started to shift the power back to the government bodies, not the party. The party was supposed to keep only the ideological and human resources, personnel duties. And again, you could see that pretty much all of the top managers, all of the top party bosses, they would be shifted into the government offices, because this is where the actual work would be doing, the actual management. Everybody but one person. Our next hero, Nikita Sergeyevich Khrushchev, who was the they actually joked that he was the only one without any government responsibilities. He was a pure party man. He made his career again in the party. He never managed any plant, any enterprise, any production. He made his career purely in the politics. And unfortunately, that gave him the unique skills, again, him and the groups that he would represent, unique ability to intrigue and play politics and pretty much rise to the top, despite having people with much, much more, I don't know, much more merit, much more experience in running a country, just leaving them behind and winning over. Again, I don't want to spend any time detailing any of the actual political battles that he led. The point is that from everything that I read, from everything that I understand about the folk, he was, like I said in one of the earlier slides, he was the ideal politician. He had no own personal beliefs. He was a career man. And he would play with the ideology to his own political benefit. That, and one of the ideological things that he played with was so-called de-Stalinization. Because he had to fight people who were the closest Stalin's helpers and comrades in arms with a lot of experience and a lot of merit, he decided to do devised a brilliant move. He blamed Stalin for everything that was wrong. And when you mix truth with lies, with more lies, and sprinkle a little bit with the truth, it starts to look believable. And that was one of the things that he used to win politically. But that, of course, changed a lot of things that people really, they changed a lot how people thought about the previous epoch. So a lot of people become, I don't know, I don't want to say disillusioned, but they started to question the course. And that was one of the things that in the end led to people completely dissociating themselves from the, not just the official ideology, but from the way of life that was promised, the way of life that was attempted to be established, and this completely disbelief in the goals. He attempted a lot of different reforms. Most of them completely failed. When they did, all he did was he blamed Stalin even more. And in the end, he was deposed because I think it was no longer possible to just tolerate that. So he spent about 10 years at the helm, and he did a lot of damage. But, and I promise that's it about that, but all the other trends that were happening besides that, all the things that the people paid for with a extraordinary effort, they did start to pay off. A lot of things, like, for example, one of the things that truly marks that period of time is the space race. And it wasn't necessarily about winning against the US. It's about just achieving this amazing feat, just achieving that, opening the humankind a road to space that resonated with everybody all across the globe, and especially, of course, with our people. Everybody who lived through that time remembers this day. Plus, of course, that gave us the more or less strategic safety because, well, space vehicles are just the missiles, the nuclear missiles just slightly repurposed. So achieving that took away a lot of the military threat that was hanging over in the previous years. At that time, the mass housing construction began. During the first industrialization in the 30s and the restoration after the war, unbelievable numbers of people moved from the country, from the villages into the cities, because we needed people to work on the plants and factories. And there was a huge housing crisis. So in the late 50s, early 60s, these cheap mass houses, apartment complexes have been built all over the country. The scale of that was mind-blowing. I put on the slide here, almost 900 million square feet in 1 year alone. Yeah, it was one of the top years, but still, other years were not that far behind. And that changed the people's lives forever. If you get, and again, if you get for free, your own apartment, when you had to live in some temporary building, or if you had to share your apartment with 3-5 other families, that marks, you know, that makes it a very, very happy day that you would remember forever. And just looking at the cities with all the construction going on, all the buildings just rising mostly, I mean, almost overnight, that cannot help but give people a lot of optimism. So that was a huge, huge cultural factor. There was, again, a very important cultural event in 1957, the World Festival of Youth and Students. Young people from all over the world visited Moscow. It was probably the first international event held in Moscow, especially of that scale, since 1917. And that also gave people the feeling of opening up. It also gave people other things, and I think Irina would mention things like some people took that opportunity to start making their own little fortunes by taking or buying Western things on the cheap from the guests and selling them to their compatriots. But it is what it is. People are different. There are different people with different interests. Of course, the overall improvement in quality of life, the overall feeling, or not the feeling, but just the state that the country has been restored, it gave way to a lot of, it boosted the culture a lot. First of all, the TV stations have been organized in most of the cities. So the TV broadcast was countrywide now. The first TV broadcast was in, I forgot, 32, I think, but the actual regular programming that spans the whole country, that happened there. So a lot of movies, a lot of theater was being filmed for TV. A lot of new cinema with a lot of new approaches to cinema with a lot of new topics emerged. Again, it felt like a huge boost in culture. And of course, the new literature. This is where we're actually getting to the Thaw part. So again, when there are extraordinary times, you need all the help you can get to just get through. And in the Soviet Union, the artists, the writers, all other culture workers, they were government employees, first of all. And second, as employees, they were an important tool in the ideological work. Doesn't mean that they were paid to lie or anything like that, but they were responsible for playing a role in shaping a new man, shaping the psyche of the new Soviet people. And yes, as the employees, the state had censorship, and it had it it set the topics. It did exercise certain control over what people were writing and what was printed on the government money. So as the extraordinarity was reduced, yes, a lot of pressure was taken away from them. Yes, they were, I don't want to say allowed, but they were let do other things. And of course, being a time of the cultural rise, they did explore new artistic forms. They explored new topics. They explored topics that were taboo before, that were not allowed or just not met with understanding in the society. A huge influx of the prose from the trenches came in. The novels written by the people who actually went through the war, not as big generals, but actually on the ground, on the field, that completely changed the shape of the literature about the war. It gave a completely different perspective on that. But also, they were especially the writers, they were still used as the ideological weapon. Except some of the old tools were put away, some of the new tools were taken out of the box. And these people actually coined the term the Thaw. It actually comes from the novel by Ilya Ehrenburg, The Thaw. The novel itself was not hugely political per se. It did touch on some of the sensitive topics, but it wasn't such a big thing. But the concept really resonated with a lot of writers, and they started calling that period that name. So it's the Thaw. We are free now. We are free of censorship, which was honestly just not true. Just the censorship rules have changed, sure. But it was a lot of new opportunity for those people, and they actually carried the fame of that period. They said it was the best period because we were free. So I babbled for long enough. I'll try to sum it up. So for the society, it was truly a new era, and not just because the government has changed. It was because the new era had emerged. It couldn't have not emerged. So the lower sense of urgency, the less pressure, not from the government, but pressure from life. It was a huge deal for people. The quality of life, just tangible results were there. So people are remembering this as a very happy time. And yes, a new topic, new agenda. That new agenda that came from the top party bosses, that was something that in the end, again, played a huge role in the fate of the Soviet Union, because the doctrine was played with too freely. It was changed to the point of being not applicable, to the point of being not believable, to the point of being not completely, but somewhat foreign to a lot of people. And that was a big trend that had its role in the demise of the Soviet Union. But the actual Thaw, it wasn't really considered that by the society itself. It was the Thaw for a lot of cultural workers and writers and artists. It was a hugely important time for them. Some of them got access to, I don't know, to the trough, to the government money, and to the hearts and ears of millions and millions of people. It was the first time they were paid to really bite the hand that fed them. They were actually paid to well, not critique, but really pour garbage on their own history. That gave them a lot of, that gave them a feeling of this false self-importance that they carried through the rest of the Soviet period. And when the Soviet Union ended, they thought that their time would come, but no. After the Soviet Union has ended, they are nobodies. And that gave a lot of people different topics, different focus. Their energy was freed from the common goal, so they were free to explore other topics and other interests. And that gave some interesting cultural phenomenon of which I believe Irina would speak. So as usual, like I said in the beginning, it's a important and controversial time, just like any other period of time in history of any other country, if you care to look deep. It's just, to me, I think I always thought it was unfair to call this period the Thaw, because it really wasn't. It was just a different time. And a lot of things that were great about this time, and there were a lot of great things about that, are not attributed to the people who made it possible, are not credited with them. There.